amazing architecture, don't you think? Yet, very few people feel good in this train station. Today, I'm here to tell you that beauty does not always go hand in hand with well-being. I had a dream. I wanted to become this architect, the one that creates stunning architecture, the one that we remember, the one that wins prizes. And so to pursue that dream, I became a student. But quickly, the dream turned into a nightmare. Stress, negativity, criticism, subjectivity. I can't breathe. And then comes that sentence. Fiona, you have a burnout.
What?
A burnout? Can you burn out when you're only 19 years old? And that's when the battle of survival begins. How do I regain my energy? How do I reduce my stress? How do I breathe again? You know what saves me? Mindfulness. Yes, really. I get my breath under control and that reduces my stress. And on my healing journey, I find myself obsessed by the brain. How can this tiny little brain have so much power? I'm so obsessed by the brain that I consider quitting architecture. Maybe I should become a neuroscientist or a psychologist. It feels like I need to make a choice. Architecture, well-being. Well-being, architecture. But then one day I wake up with the idea. I am going to combine these two worlds, create mindful spaces, and this is going to be my thesis subject. I work on it for months, but the subject got rejected. My teacher looks at me and says, "Fiona, you should remove everything that's related to mindfulness from your thesis, because that is going to scare off the jury." Really? We are talking about mindfulness. The problem is, she's the teacher, I'm the student. I'm not confident enough to pursue without her blessing. Maybe she is right. Maybe architects have no responsibility when it comes to well-being. So she wins. I quit. But I come back. Do you know why? Because life gives me time. Because suddenly, we're all stuck at home, remember? And suddenly, everyone sees how important it is to feel good at home. Everyone sees the link between architecture and well-being. So something switches in me. I'm not going to wait for my teachers to be ready. I'm not going to wait for approval from a jury. And I am not going to wait for the architectural world to take up their responsibility. So I come back with one goal. Prove that design influences well-being. And guess what? I do prove it every day. Today it's my work, thanks to neuroarchitecture. What is neuroarchitecture? It's the combination between neuroscience and architecture, the study of how the mind reacts to space. But what does that mean? Well, let me remind you that we can divide the brain in two parts, the conscious mind and the unconscious mind. The conscious mind thinks, the unconscious mind doesn't. The conscious mind understands, the unconscious mind is just made to protect us. Well, in architecture today, we create spaces so that the conscious mind feels safe. That's why we have a roof above our heads, walls, double glazing, to protect us. The problem is, the unconscious mind doesn't. And I'm gonna show you how through examples. Examples that are going to illustrate the three pillars of neuroarchitecture. An open space. Do you think we feel safe in an open space? Of course we do. There's a roof above our head, there are walls, and probably your colleagues aren't here to kill you. So you do feel safe. But the unconscious mind doesn't. Whenever something can happen behind you, the unconscious mind puts itself in what we call alert modus. Because if something would happen, he's the one that needs to send a signal of reflex to the body. We know that open spaces are draining. That is why we created silent rooms. But even in silent rooms, there are do's and don'ts. Which one do you think is best for our well-being? The second one. Because there is a wall behind us. Because there is a feeling of protection. A sense of control over who passes by. The first one is as if I would turn around and talk to you with my back towards you. My conscious mind would feel safe, because I guess you're good people. But my unconscious mind would feel threatened. Ladies, how do you recognize a gentleman? If he lets you sit on the banquet, of course. We tend to prefer the banquet, and there is a reason for that. Because again, there is a feeling of control. There is control over who enters and who gets out. So this is the first pillar of neuroarchitecture. We need to learn to organize space differently, to organize space so that the unconscious mind feels safe. Let me remind you how architecture has started, with a cavern. Our ancestors created a cavern to protect from danger. Well, close your eyes and picture a cavern in your mind. How does it look? There is one entrance. There is a feeling of protection. So this is the first pillar of neuroarchitecture. The second key pillar is that we need to learn to use color consciously. Look at these black ceilings. Maybe you think they're pretty, maybe not. That's not really my debate right now. When you get out of your home in the morning and the sky is blue, how do you feel? There is a sense of lightness, of clarity. Whereas, when you come out of your home in the morning and the sky is gray, how do you feel? There is a sense of heaviness, of threat. We even say it in our vocabulary. It's going to fall down on us. So again, the conscious mind does feel safe. We know that no rain can fall from a ceiling. But the unconscious mind feels a threat. And recently, I saw a black ceiling in a retirement home. Well, let me tell you that elderly people entering a retirement home feel threatened. Do we need to reinforce that with design? Of course not. Here's another example. Red cafeterias, something I do see a lot lately. The red color activates the entire nervous system. Think about it. Where do we see red color in society? Red light. I may not pass. Signalization boards. Interdiction. At school. Mistakes. So there is a feeling of anger and interdiction linked to the red color. Do you think that is a feeling we need to learn to eat mindfully? To live in the present moment? Of course not. And I could talk about color for hours. But what I need you to remember is that color is more than what we see. Color is a vibration. Color is an energy. The third pillar of neuroarchitecture is that we need to learn to leave the ego behind. Architects today are designing for prizes, awards, recognition, social media. Look at this hotel room, a perfect example. The more mind-blowing it is, the more success it receives. And let me tell you that this kind of bedroom doesn't permit restorative sleep, good sleep. But we don't care, because it's pretty, because we please the eye, because today it's more about what we see than what we feel. And when I'm talking about the ego, I'm not only talking about architects, I'm talking about us as individuals. We need to learn to stop caring so much. Care about the trends, technology, likes, views, Instagram. That's not what our homes should be about. So these are the three pillars of neuroarchitecture. Organize space differently, use color consciously, and leave the ego behind. I'm giving examples about interiors, But this also goes for the entire architectural world. Because imagine a world in which, thanks to architecture, we would improve sleep, reduce stress, reduce fatigue, accelerate healing, stimulate growth. That's how powerful neuroarchitecture is. So what is all of this supposed to teach us? That we have grown out of our basic needs. That we have forgotten the main purpose of our home. I do have good news. Architects are becoming aware of their responsibility here. They are starting to design for change, for healing, human and planet. We know we need to use nature to reduce stress. We need natural light for well-being. We use sustainable materials. So I believe that change is happening, really. I just think we're forgetting the mind. I just think it starts to designing with the brain in mind. Because we can only heal the planet if we heal ourselves first. We can only give energy if we have energy. So remember this. If a flower doesn't bloom, you fix the environment, not the flower.